to the meeting of the Liverpool City Region Combined Authority. This meeting will be broadcast live to the Combined Authority website and available for subsequent viewing. So on entering this room, you are consenting to being filmed and to the possible use of those images and or sound recordings for filming purposes. Members and officers, please ensure that you press the microphone before speaking and turn it off afterwards, if at all possible. And finally, can everyone ensure that their phone switched to silent, please? So item one is apologies for absence. And Jonathan Varley will report the apologies that have been received.
Thank you, Chairman. We've had apologies from Mayor Anderson, Chief Hammond, and Councillor Cathy Mitchell from West Lodge.
Are there any further apologies? No? Okay, two is declarations of interest for members. Three are the minutes of the Combined Authority meeting of the 22nd of July 2022. Can I ask that those minutes are agreed, please? Four is announcements and lots and lots to say and lots to cover. But first up, I'm happy to report that our region continues to be the home of rugby league champions, St Helens, after winning a historic fourth straight Super League title. Now, I think the leader of St Helens Council, Councillor David Baines, might want to say something about a celebrating word or two about that achievement.
Thank you very much. I'm really grateful for the opportunity to come in at this point and just to say a few words, just to echo that. It's a fantastic achievement for Saints to win four titles in a row. Really proud to be the leader of St Helens Council and with them as our greatest ambassadors. And I think it's a huge achievement for our whole region. And I just want to say that we're really proud of Saints, but also really proud to be hosting three games in St Helens in the Rugby League World Cup, which kicks off this weekend. Tomorrow in Newcastle, with England against Samoa. We've got three huge games at Saints. I'm pleased to say you'll be joining us for one of those, so I'm looking forward to that. Huge games featuring Tonga, world champion Australia, Wales, Papua New Guinea and Italy. We're also proud to be hosting the Tonga and Italian men's squad at St Helens, and we welcome Tonga to our town hall on Tuesday for a fantastic civic reception. And what's most important with any tournament like this, what we all care about most is our communities, our children and young people, and I'm really pleased to say that the Rugby League World Cup has delivered £1.6 million in grant funding for improvements to pitches, clubhouses, playing equipment, all sorts of things for our local clubs in St Helens, the amateur game, and that's the lasting legacy that we want from tournaments like this. So thank you for allowing me to congratulate Saints again, Mr. Mayor, and look forward to seeing you all, hopefully, at World Cup games over the next few weeks.
I'd encourage anybody who hasn't been to a rugby league game to go. You'll be back, I tell you, that they are frightening spectacles in regard to the physicality of what you're watching. Going from one success to the next one, of course, unless you've been away somewhere that has no television or radio or communications, you will have missed that Liverpool was successful in their bid to hold the Eurovision Song Contest. And I've just been over to the arena in the convention centre where Tim Davie is, and there's a gathering there of people from across the city region, and the plans are already starting to take shape. There's a huge opportunity for us all, isn't there, that the city region needs to benefit, just as Councillor Baines talked about the legacy for St Helens and the rugby. The whole city region needs to benefit from the legacy of the Eurovision Song Contest. Worldwide TV audiences of billions of people, potentially hundreds, certainly tens of thousands of people will be visiting the city region over those few weeks, because everyone thinks it's a one-off. It's not. There's a massive build-up, and then there'll be people still around afterwards. And so a great chance for all of us to showcase everything that we're proud of in our city region. The warmth and the friendliness of people is always taken for granted, but when people come here, they'll be absolutely blown away by not just the spectacle, but the way in which Liverpool and of course the rest of the city region will come together for this. The visitor economy will benefit massively, and that's why we agreed that we would invest ourselves into the event. But we have to be really cognizant of the fact that this is happening in Liverpool. It has unfortunately lost there. So whilst it's here, we'll be doing it in the best way that we can, but you'll see that there's a very real flavour of Ukraine right the way throughout. The contest will be one that I don't think anybody will forget. I've just been speaking over at the Arena Convention Centre about what happened in 2008, and not just the wonderful buildings that we opened during 2008, but the legacy was that the people of Liverpool really found their civic pride again. And I think that this is going to be another of those occasions that in the 13th of May 2023, I think everybody again will be behind this, and I will see that civic pride return, which is a fantastic legacy in itself. I'm sure Councillor Jane Corbett might want to come in here, who's deputised on behalf of the Mayor of Liverpool, but of course it is Liverpool that's been supported by the Combined Authority.
Yeah, thank you, Steve. Just a massive thank you to the other leaders in the different authorities. It's a city region funded event, but it obviously will link up with the region, but it's held in Liverpool. So, and we certainly see it as something that will help us not only protect but transform the economy as well. It's a huge opportunity, and the link directly with the Ukraine and the mayor of Odessa is really, really important as well. It's important for them, it's important for us, and it brings excitement and hope into a particularly difficult time with the cost of living crisis, and it will be really helpful for people to see that this is coming. The feedback I've had from local people so far has been very, very positive, because they can see how much difference this will make within the local economy, but also in terms of people having something to look forward to as well and aim for. So absolutely brilliant. And we've got, you know, we've all got a good history, but Liverpool particularly has got a good history of culture and celebration. So good party coming, I reckon. Thank you.
Great city for a great party. The most common question I'm asked, any tickets?
Declaration of interest there, Metro. Yeah, get offered one.
Yeah, no. They're asking me to get their tickets. So we're all going to be asked for them. But yeah, what a great opportunity for us. We will do justice to it, I'm absolutely certain. And of course, everyone will be aware that September's meeting was cancelled, and it was cancelled due to the early morning following the death of Her Majesty the Queen after 70 years of dignified and devoted service to the country. We took the decision to cancel last month's meeting as a mark of respect, but as ever, there were some important items on the agenda that still needed to be approved, and so we used delegated authority on a number of those, such as funding support for Liverpool's Eurovision bid, and as we know, that was the right thing to do because we were successful. We also approved Access for All programmes, and our submission for funding was due to the Department of Transport by the 16th of September, so we needed to ensure that we didn't miss that deadline. And then the third one was around Liverpool John Lennon Airport, which we've obviously discussed at length previously. And since the last meeting, we've decided to delay the consultation on the spatial development strategy, which is a statutory requirement, but it's in light of recent government announcements, and I don't really know, but probably while we're here, there's a news conference on Downing Street where there might be an announcement on the future of the Chancellor. So that's how fast moving things are happening. However, we're still committed to complete the SDS as comprehensively and as quickly as we possibly can, and we'll give further updates as we do that. Councillor Morgan, I don't know whether you just wanted to come in on the SDS.
Yeah, thanks, Chairman. Thanks for the updates as well, and I welcome what you just said. And we'll continue to work on the good work in the SDS, and we will be publishing a place focused strategy which will highlight the great place opportunities within the city region. So rest assured that we're still carrying on with the excellent work that we're doing, and the reports will be published shortly. Thank you.
Thanks, Councillor Morgan. I've just had the update because I've been in that meeting I just told you about, and Kwasi's actually gone, so fast moving or what? So we've got someone in the city region that's just saw energy prices double or mortgage payments soar, pensions threatened by extraordinary levels of borrowing, or you're on universal credit and uncertain about how you can keep pace with inflation during the winter. It's really worrying times for lots of the people that we all represent, and as always, the CA will do what we can do to support as many as we can. And you can see that in some of the items that we'll vote on in the agenda. But we really do need the government to get to grips at the moment, because the situation that many are facing is absolutely dire. Now, last month saw the return of the Labour Party conference to Liverpool after a 4-year hiatus because of COVID and other things. Obviously something I'm naturally pleased about, but it's not just because it was my political party that was hosting its annual conference in our place, but because thousands of journalists, of businesses, of lobbyists, of members of the public and members of the party and campaigners flocked to the city during those few days. And they do spend a few bob while they're here too. And so the economic boost is really important. And hopefully, again, they all feel the warmth of the welcome to Liverpool and enjoy the fantastic waterfronts and the amazing visitor economy, because many will return, and certainly they will for the Labour Party conference next year, and the year after, and the year after. And so Labour's going to hold many of its party conferences in sequence over the next few years in Liverpool, which is brilliant for us and for the economy. That, just to let you know that, as I've said previously, anybody who does leave the phone on, because it was mentioned at the beginning, does now owe the Mayor's charity £10. So that's another £10. So just being here, we've already raised money for charity, which is brilliant. It's a fantastic week. The Labour Party conference this year is Keir Starmer set out an exciting and ambitious vision for the future of the whole country. But it was some of the key commitments that I think we all picked up on, and they were around the tidal power announcement, which was just brilliant for us, and I think really exciting. Like Councillor David Baines, who's our portfolio lead on this, and others, this could be transformational for our city region. And of course, the government have committed, sorry, the Labour government would commit to the Hillsborough law now. And the government appeared to be, because I went to the Tory party conference, they seemed to be more interested in talking about bankers' bonuses, to tell you the truth, while I was there, and tax breaks, and not the day-to-day stuff that people are really concerned about. But I did meet a number of secretaries of state while I was in Birmingham, and because they are the government of the day, we have to talk to whoever it is that signs the checks. You know, we represent 1.6 million people of all different political persuasions, so I was happy to take the fight to their own backyard and to outline some of the potential that we have in the city region. It's starting to be recognised, the things that we're doing at a governmental level, but also within their own party. They were talking about some of the innovation that's happening in the local city region, which I thought was really interesting. And I had a number of positive meetings about the future of devolution and for the investment in that innovation in our area. And I know I also spoke on behalf of our local authorities when I said that we needed sustainable funding settlements for the six LAs who have been hit some of the hardest in the whole country, cumulatively over 12 years. Now, today, the Combined Authority has submitted an expression of interest to the government for a number of potential sites to become investment zones, and all of the leaders, including myself, have numerous grave reservations about the policy itself and the lack of detail. And we've outlined all of our concerns clearly in a letter. It was to Kwasi Kwarteng, believe it or not, just earlier, but we'll send it to Simon Clark and whoever Kwasi's replacement is. Is that being announced? No? Okay, we'll open a book on that one. But that'll be alongside the EOI. And clearly, this is only dipping our toe in the water. We've made it clear that we'll not agree to any dilution of workers' rights, environmental standards or planning regulations. And we want clarification about the mitigations the government are going to put in place to prevent displacement between regions, but also region to region as well. trans in Berlin a few weeks ago, because we launched our new battery powered train to a European audience, and you'd have to be there, but you'll have to believe that people really, really interested at this event. Huge numbers of people taking photos of every single part of our trains. It's the first battery operated train in the UK. I think where we've led, others will follow once again. Just over the weekend, I was at a global mayor's conference in Holland, and I formed links with lots and lots of global mayors. I've been there a few times to the global mayor's conference, and again, they were really interested in what we're doing, and we're asking questions about science and innovation, the fourth industrial revolution, the green industrial revolution, Liverpool becoming Britain's renewable energy coast and all that. So again, to a global audience, people start to pick up on what we're doing. And lastly, as always, every month we try to get round to as much of the city region as we possibly can. And in the summer, I went to Crosby Lakeside Adventure Centre, and its newly refurbished premises look fantastic. They've had £3 million of city region funding, and it's now open. It is open now, isn't it, to all visitors, and anybody who has been there, go and have a look and spend the afternoon around there. It's brilliant. Similarly, I went to Knowsley's long-awaited Shakespeare Theatre to talk to some of the FASJAB, Defence and Social Justice Advisory Board members, and that was only yesterday. It was brilliant, and they've done some fantastic work on our behalf for 5 years. And then later this month, I'm going to be at the new Eureka Science and Discovery Museum on the Willow Neck Gate. We've been waiting for years for this to happen, but it's literally on our radar now, and just a few weeks to go. And I'm going to Lee Green and St Helens, and also I'll be in Holt before the end of years out, seeing firsthand how the Active Travel Fund is being used to open up new opportunities for walking and cycling. I'm told I'm not a cycling expert or an active travel expert, but it's an exemplar that other areas in the country are already taking notice of, so that's brilliant again if we're leading in the city region. So I think that's enough now for what we're doing, but we'll now start the formalities of the meeting with the agenda on item 5, and the first report is the final report of the apprenticeship task and finished group, and I'm very pleased that Councillor Steve Bradford, who's the chair of overview and scrutiny, is here to present the report of that task and finished group. And so, Councillor Bradford, if you want to take us through the report, and then we'll open it up for any questions.
Before I do, Chairman, if you don't mind me just mentioning, can members of the local authorities pass my particular thanks on to the support of all the members of the Overview and Screening Committee. I think we've had a very constructive year, and I know some of your members take great strides to attend the meetings, often against very difficult time frames. So we'd like to express our thanks for their support, and I'd like to express our thanks for the support of your officers, who've given some very detailed presentations and answered some very robust questions. So I'd like to express my personal thanks before I start formal item, if you don't mind, Mr. Chairman. I feel slightly cheeky presenting this report because I wasn't actually a member of the start and finish group, even though it's a background that I worked with the former mayor in a previous life, and with great pleasure in doing so. The review was taking place in April 21, and as you can understand, there was quite a bit of a business turmoil, was probably the best description, in that period due to COVID and the impact on the labour market. And I think we'll still even see unexpected impact on the labour market and lifestyles for employment since. The Task and Finish Group, their membership is on Appendix 1, which is page 21. And I'd like to give thanks to all of them because they did the work. And there were 3 evidence sessions, and I would like to give thanks to all the people who gave evidence, and that is detailed on pages 22 to 23 in the report. Their evidence was critical to to forming an articulate evidence-based report. Some of those findings, I have to say, were surprising. The conclusions of the report are on paragraphs 3.5 and 3.7, and clearly they were, if I be candid, were a surprise to me that there was a lack of precision and knowledge amongst the employment market of the benefits and what opportunities and what particular routes there were for apprenticeships. So I think that's a challenge for all of us. So the report's before you. I can't say I would be a great ability to answer any comments on that, but I'd like to thank everybody who contributed so much to compiling the report, and thank you for the privilege of attending today.
Thanks, Councillor Radford. It's not like a politician to bask in the glory of something that they haven't done, so it's very honest of you to mention your predecessors. But the report is accompanied by an action plan. It's been developed by officers at the CA in response to the recommendations by the Task and Finish Group. Kirsty, have you got anything to add to what's been said?
I think that's been a really helpful update. I think the only thing to add is obviously, as you mentioned, this was done during a time of COVID, but a lot of the issues still remain. And it is something which will continue discussions with government about how we support apprenticeships work and planning to put those recommendations into effect.
Any questions? Okay, on behalf of the CA, can I welcome and thank you all the scrutiny committee's work on this and their work more generally in providing oversight and transparency in the work of the Combined Authority. It really is important work, you can quite right, Councillor Radford. The quorum is always an issue for us and getting enough members to make a quorum. But the work that they've done is really important to everything that we do here, certainly around the transparency of this organisation. So if we can agree the recommendations, then they're on page 15. 6 is the Audit Committee function, and it's a report that falls under my portfolio of policy reform and resources, and it's about changes to the remit of the LCR Audit and Governance Committee. So I'm going to ask Jill Cooley, who's our Chief Legal Officer and Monitoring Officer, to present the report.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. The report outlines a proposed change to the terms of the current Audit and Governance Committee from the Combined Authority, and it will effectively request that we extend the remit of the committee so that it can also cover Mersey travel as a distinct legal entity. With your permission, it is proposed that those changes be made, and I'm happy to take any questions.
Anything for Jill? No, can we read the recommendations that are on page 31? Mm-hmm. 7 is a report on Mersey Rail services, and people will remember the disruption to services across the Mersey Rail network late May, early July 2022, and it was as a result, we all remember, of bearing faults associated with the old stock, so it's called the Class 507 and 508 fleet. Councillor Robinson, with the portfolio holder, is going to take us through the report and then hand over to Richard McCookin, who's going to add anything that Councillor Robinson doesn't.
Yeah, thanks very much. I'm very much going to briefly introduce the report before handing over to Richard, because obviously, as you rightfully indicated, the report deals with the passenger disruption that was experienced in May of this year on the Mersey Rail network owing to the wheel bearing faults with the existing 507, 508 fleet of trains. It obviously references the immediate safety work that Mersey Rail and staff have put in place to ensure that operation remains safe, but also talks about the joint work that Mersey Rail, Network Rail and Stadler as the maintenance provider put in place to investigate the issue, but also make sure that we returned as quickly as possible back to full service. With Richard being a chartered engineer, he's much better qualified than I to go through the technical elements of the report, so I'm going to hand over to him.
Thanks, Councillor Robinson. The report sets out the key issues we're experiencing. I think I'd use the word unprecedented disruption and unprecedented number of failures of bearings in the axles. normally you'd expect to see sort of two per month. We saw 300 in the course of several weeks, caused by electrical faults somewhere either on the rolling stock or on the infrastructure. Whilst the Combined Authority and Mersey Travel as a contracting body aren't responsible for the operations, there was assurance was sought, and officers and Metro Mayor sought that assurance by bringing those partners together to ensure that all action was taken immediately to identify the root cause and, most importantly, get the trains back into service for the travelling public to not suffer any further disruption. There were a number of measures that have been, actions that have been taken and are ongoing, as Councillor Robinson has suggested. Paragraph 3.4 of the report sets some of those out, not least the appointment of an independent investigation company, SC Lavalin, who are investigating the various aspects of possible causes of fault. Their independent report is due imminently, and when the findings of that are made available, I will certainly provide an update to interested parties. Network Rail, as the infrastructure asset owners, have conducted a number of tests and examinations and identified some faults and some areas where excessive power is being loaded into the infrastructure, but of course the report will highlight whether that was a factor or not. So I will seek that further reassurance, and the report also does reference the new Class 777 trains, which have been tested and have a completely different bearing, construction and makeup, and would not suffer the same vulnerabilities as the existing fleet have done. So the Combined Authority asked at this point to note the interim report.
And of course, when the independent assessment is carried out, we'll have a further report that comes to this end and be made public. That might shut up some of the conspiracy theorists on social media, fingers crossed. Any questions on anything there? Now, can we note that report then, please? 8 is a report that falls under my portfolio of policy, form and resources. And I'm going to ask John Fogarty, who's the Executive Director of Corporate Services, to present the update on the Combined Authority's financial performance at the end of the last quarter. John?
Thank you, Metro Mayor. Yes, this report sets out the capital and revenue position of the Combined Authority at the end of August. There are, within the report, you'll see a number of variations, mostly positive. In particular, that highlight the financial performance of the tunnels being particularly encouraging in the first part of the year. The report also highlights, as we've touched upon elsewhere in the meeting, that some of the risks that are arising from current economic environment, and in particular inflation, interest rates, and other potential movements towards the end of the year, which we're monitoring very closely, and we'll report back here. Capital spend will pick up significantly in the latter half of the current year, as some of our bigger projects in the year have already moved into firmly into delivery. And again, we'll report those back in subsequent financial reports. And we're happy to pick up any questions arising from that report.
Any questions for John? Now, can we note, can we agree the recommendation? It's on page 51. 9 is a UK Shared Prosperity Fund, and again, this is another one that falls in my portfolio, and the paper sets out our proposed delivery plan for the UK Shared Prosperity Fund. And the plan's been developed from the investment plan that was approved at the Combined Authority meeting in July. As a reminder, UK Shared Prosperity Fund is government's replacement for the former EU funding, which supported vital initiatives right the way across the city region. And the government promised us that there would be no area worse off as a result of the loss of EU funding. However, our loss is about 37%, about £10.2 million each year on a headline basis. And in practice, the scale of reduction is greater than the city region, because we previously benefited from the relocation of centres, cultural heritage, and activity to tackle antisocial behaviour, food poverty, and to improve green spaces. Now, the Combined Authority has and will continue to work closely with our local authorities, our key development partners and stakeholders across the city region to put delivery arrangements in place to ensure that despite the reductions in funding, that we maximise the impact and deliver at pace to relieve the pressure on residents caused by the cost of living crisis. And we'll help support local communities as much as we possibly can. But look, let's face it, the bottom line is we've got less money to do the things that last year we would have done. And of course, with inflation, that eats away even further at the baseline of that funding. So you can see that people are going to be struggling even more, and local authorities potentially struggling to deliver some of the things that previously it did deliver. We need to ensure again that people are aware of why this is happening, because it's nothing to do with our local authorities. I don't know whether Aileen, you've got anything to add at the point.
Not much, thanks, Metro Mayor. This is about mobilising the delivery plan for the UK Shared Prosperity Fund, as you said, targeted at really key priorities, dealing with the cost of living crisis and the provision of financial support and welfare advice to vulnerable residents across the city region. And the second aspect, working in partnership with our local authorities on the place and communities aspect, as you said. Thank you.
Any questions for you? Now, can we read the recommendations? They're on page 79.
Really?
The new Chancellor of the Exchequer is Jeremy Hunt, former Secretary of State for Health and at DCMS. I worked with him and opposed him at DCMS. I'll leave it at that. I wish him every success. Item 10 is the structural arrangements for the Chrysalis and the Growing Places Fund, and we're being asked to consider aligning the Chrysalis Fund with the Liverpool City Region Urban Development Fund and the Growing Places Fund into a much more streamlined structure to reduce costs and improve efficiencies. Now, this item contains several exempt appendices, and if anyone wishes to discuss the contents of any of these documents, the monitoring officer will guide us through what we need to do. But Councillor Williamson, I think this is the first of several items that she will introduce and then hand over to Dr. Aileen Jones, who's our Executive Director of Investment and Delivery.
Thank you, Metro, and thank you for the update on the Chancellor's position. Let's just hope that Jeremy Hunt does not replicate his less than successful tenure in the NHS in his new position. Unfortunately, my reports are very interesting, but they're not going to be a patch on the rather exciting and chaotic developments that are taking place nationally at the minute. But I'll endeavour to start the first of quite a few today. So, thank you. The Chrysalis Fund is a £34 million investment fund originally established in 2012. It's been very successful, having supported 13 projects, creating 1.5 million square foot of commercial space and supporting nearly 5,000 jobs. It's also made a surplus over that time, £500,000 already returned to support the Combined Authority's COVID response and allocated to LCR cares. The report recommends a further £1,600,000 to be returned to the Combined Authority to support future projects. And it is anticipated that at least a further £1 million will become available on repayment of existing loans. The original investment period of the fund has now come to an end, and this provides us with the opportunity to consider how to use such funds going forward. There is an ongoing need for the type of loan support that Chrysalis and our Development Fund can provide. This is likely to be increasingly the case given the current economic circumstances, which are literally changing by the second, and caution from banks and investors. However, the administrative arrangements for the fund can be streamlined and brought under closer control of the Combined Authority. This will also enable the fund to be combined with our Urban Development Fund in due course. The report sets out detailed proposals in this respect. The report also asks us to reconfirm the use of the Growing Places Fund to invest in commercial projects and provide provide the opportunity to combine the funding with Chrysalis should this be required to meet demand. Whilst not included in the report, can I also note that the Department of Levelling Up Housing and Communities, if it still exists, have recently informed the Combined Authority that they will be adding a further £15 million to the Urban Development Fund, recognising the success of our commercial funds, and rightly so, might I say, Mr Mayor.
Thanks, Councillor Williamson. I'm tempted to put my comment to. Any questions?
Do you not know how long Jeremy Hunt will last?
If I knew that, I'd be a very rich woman, Councillor.
Okay, if there are no questions, can we read the recommendations as set out on page 89, please? 11 is some material changes to what we previously agreed on SIF fund projects. And it's Councillor Williamson, again, who's going to introduce the report.
Yes, thank you. I shall try and canter through these reports so everyone doesn't get as sick of my voice as I'm already beginning to be. So, thank you, Mr. Mayor. In line with our constitution, material changes to projects require our consideration and approval. There is only one change highlighted in the paper in respect of the People Network projects. As members will recall, People had developed an inclusive technology platform that provides local restaurants and retailers with an ordering and delivery solution. Funding was originally approved in February 2021 during the COVID-19 lockdown and acknowledged at the time to be a progressive but a higher risk project. As the lockdowns didn't last as long as expected, the environment for local restaurants and retailers has changed and the project has needed to adapt. Whilst the project has created a vehicle for supporting more sustainable and equitable business models, not all the funding originally allocated is now appropriate, and the paper recommends that we reduce this by £200,000. It's also proposed, as set out in the paper, to revise the required outputs and timescales in light of the changed environment. Thank you.
Any questions? Okay, can we agree those recommendations? They're on page 113. 12 is another exciting development which Seven have been working on for some considerable time, and we're being asked to approve £17.7 million of funding from the Strategic Investment Fund to support the development of what's called Marine Lake Events Centre, and that's in Southport. And the item again contains an exempt appendix, and if we did want to discuss the content of the appendix, the Monitoring Officer again will guide us through what we need to do. But Councillor Williamson, again, over to you, and I'm saying that Councillor May want to come in after yourself and Dr. Hayley Jones.
Thank you, Metro Mayor. The paper seeks approval for £17.7 million of capital funding for the Marine Lake Events Centre on the waterfront in Southport. Currently, the site of the Southport Theatre and Convention Centre, which is closed. The Marine Lake Centre will be a new multi-purpose event space, which will support the wider place-based regeneration of the area. Support for its visitor economy, it will create jobs and support economic growth. It forms a centrepiece of Sefton Council's National Towns Fund bid, for which they've received an award of £38.5 million, and the full business case was submitted for formal approval in August 2022. Subject to funding and planning approvals, the project is due to commence demolition of the old venue next spring, with the main construction running from the end of 2023 to 2025. Following a rigorous selection process, the multinational venue operator AMG Global has been appointed to partner with Sefton in running the new event and exhibition space and will open doors to the public in April 2026. At the heart of the project lies a commitment to environmental sustainability, provision of secure local jobs and benefiting local businesses through increased visitor numbers and the use of local supply chains. Southport is already benefiting from increased investment as a positive outcome from the town investment plan, whether through repurposing of the town's department stores, developing tourist-related attractions, and diversifying the economy with stronger professional and career tech businesses. A stronger Southport benefits the whole city region, providing leisure and business visitors with more reasons to visit and invest in the region, as well as providing a place where people want to live and work. And I'm sure most of us in this room have really fond memories of Southport. It's fantastic to see it being regenerated like this. Thank you.
Absolutely fond memories. Dr. Jones.
Thanks, Major Mayor. As Councillor Williams said, this is a pivotal element of the economic region of emphasise for supporting the visitor economy, creation of jobs and greater economic growth for the area. Thank you.
Councillor May, I'm sure you want to add your perspective, having worked on it for so long.
Thanks, Steve. I can't stress the importance of this for the economy of the North of Ireland and Tadbrook in particular, in the regeneration of our visitor ask, our visitor offer, or going back, because we haven't been able to in recent times, of course, because of the conditions of the old centre, going back into conferences, etc. What it does, Steve, what it does is show us what we went through back in 2015 when the leaders at the time said, we want to do this because we don't want to be jumping through those Westminster hoops and getting nowhere, as we were continually doing as local authority areas. And I'm absolutely certain that this funding, we wouldn't be sitting here talking about this funding, or we in SEPTIM wouldn't be getting this funding, probably a better way of putting it, if we hadn't established the Combined Authority and the Metro Mail Combined Authority.